Well, good morning and welcome to our 10 o'clock service today. Hello to everyone in the building and hello if you're on Zoom. My name is Joe and I'm the curate here, and later on Sarah will be talking to us. Now, I hope you're all relatively cool at the moment, and I hope it stays that way over the coming days. But for now, let's just take a moment of peace, a moment of still, where we can welcome the Holy Spirit with us here in this place. Holy Spirit, come. Amen. And we start the service this morning with the words on the screen. Please join in with the text in bold. Loving God, we have come to worship you. Help us to pray to you in faith, to sing your praise with gratitude, and to listen to your word with eagerness. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. And we now spend a moment of time to say sorry to God for the bad choices we have made, which we regret. Let's just have a moment of quiet. And we say together the words on the screen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life. To the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we say together the collect, the prayer for today. Almighty God, send down your church, the riches of your Spirit, and kindle in all who minister the gospel your countless gifts of grace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, now I hand over to Suzanne and the band as we worship in song. Take my life and let it be.
Thank you.
pray that you do take us all, whatever we are and wherever we go. Be with us, Father. Amen. Please be seated. And we now have Sarah coming up to interview me.
Well, Joe, I thought it'd be really good for you to tell us a bit about Messy Church, because we're coming towards the end of this summer term.
That's right.
And you've been in charge for basically since September, so it's been a whole academic year.
It has.
And I think there's one or two people here who maybe haven't even sampled the delights of Messy, which is, you know, you're missing out, guys, but that's all good. That's your choice. So, Joe, do you want to just start off and tell us a bit about what happens at Messy Church?
Okay. Well, at a normal Messy Church, there are various craft activities which are all based around a theme which is normally a biblical story or something that we're trying to teach. So there'll be craft activities where you can cut and stick and make things. And there's usually a game, something active, and sometimes a treasure hunt or things like that. And then after a while, we come into here, and there's a little talk and some songs, and sometimes even a puppet show. And then we finish off with having coffee and tea and cake.
Yeah, that goes down pretty well,
it does,
doesn't it?
Yeah,
the kids are usually out the door before we've said the messy grace, to be honest.
Yeah.
Who comes, Joe? If the church isn't full of most of these guys, who is coming?
Yeah, well, there are a few people here I know who do come along, but it's mainly aimed at families with primary school age children who are kind of on the fringe of church. So it's people that don't necessarily know church as well as we do. And that's what it's aimed at. So it is more of a evangelical type of thing, I guess.
That's a really good way of putting it, that it's people who don't know church as well as we do. And I think we'd all agree that it's a congregation in its own right, Messy Church, isn't it? We've got folk who only come to our messy churches, and that's wonderful. They're coming and we're worshipping together, and it's our own little congregation, isn't it?
It is.
Joe, can you think of what your favourite activity's been in the last year? I didn't give him any warning of this, so I'll give you a heads up, because mine was probably, there was a really good messy one recently, wasn't there, where there was we had to find alphabet letters in shaving foam and just get covered in it. And I think the children really enjoyed that one. They love it when it gets a little bit messy.
I mean,
who doesn't really?
Yeah, indeed.
And the helpers is probably the answer to that.
Yeah.
Have you had a favourite?
I enjoyed, when we did Noah's Ark, we had lots of boxes. I don't even remember, I did ask for people to bring along boxes, and we made a huge ark, and the kids really loved making it, and they also enjoyed destroying it too. It was a constant state of being made and destroyed, so that was a bit of fun.
That's brilliant.
Yeah.
What's going on this afternoon, Jim?
Yeah, well, today, as you're saying, we're coming to the end of term, where there isn't a messy church in August. And so this is the last one of the term, and we're having a bit of a party. It's going to be slightly different. We're still going to have crafts and a talk and a song, but we're also having a bouncy castle and a barbecue. So it's going to be a bit more of a party atmosphere, and some of the games and things that we'll be doing are more of a sort of party feel to them. So it should be good fun.
Fantastic. And wanted to acknowledge, I don't think, oh, Steve is here, but all of this messy church is building on what was started, I'm not sure when it was started, 2017, 2018, by Steve and Barbara Williams. Mm. They started that work and really passed it over. Obviously, we took a break in COVID, it was enforced, but it was a moment for them to pass on the ministry that they'd began. But it's just to say what brilliant foundation we've been able to build on. So Steve's at the back there, and special thank you to you and Barbara, who had the vision to bring it to St. Francis Church, because it's a wonderful way that we can engage with the school particularly, isn't it? That
it is.
We do find some of the folk who go to the school coming over, and it's quite widely known in the community. They'll often say, is it on this month or not? Mm. So that's been good fun.
Yeah.
plans going forward, Joe? We're going to just start again in September after this and keep going, basically.
Yeah, that's awesome. Right.
That's
wonderful. But, take the opportunity to thank everyone who's involved with it and all the volunteers we have. You know who you are, and thank you ever so much, because without you guys helping, it just wouldn't happen.
That's it. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah, it's much more than it's much more than a team affair. It's much less to do with those of us who lead, and much more to do with all of you who cut out the crafts faithfully each week, who make the teas and coffees and bring the cakes along. It's impossible without all of you. So massively appreciated. It's a huge ministry that this church has, and I guess possibly one that isn't as it's not so visible on a Sunday morning, is it, inevitably? And Joe's been heading it up, which has been great. So just wanted to bring that to our attention this morning before the party. You're really welcome to pop along later. If you've got kids, bring them. If you haven't got kids and you'd like to come, you're still as welcome. So feel free to pop in. Thank you. Shall I say, why don't we pray for our messy church party later? Lord, thank you so much for all that Steve and Barbara did in their vision those years ago to bring Messy Church to St. Francis, and for the many lives it's touched. And thank you for Joe, who's taken it on over the past academic year. And Lord, thank you so much for the families who come along, the fun that we have, and for all those who volunteer and support, who make the tea and who clear up the shaving foam. Lord, I just want to especially thank you for those guys who come in and do the hoovering and cleaning at the end of the day. It's a super unglamorous job, but there's a wonderful team who do that, and we are so grateful. Lord, we pray for this afternoon's party, that you would draw people along even though it's hot, and that you would enable people to know the welcome and the fun that is happening here, that they might know that there are friends here and a community that they are a part of. Would you bless that time, Lords, and would you bless all those who will support and lead it, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thanks, Lovely. Joe.
Thank you. And we now have the reading for today, read by Heather.
Good morning, everyone. The reading is taken from the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 10, beginning to read at verse 38. Now, as they went on their way, he entered a certain village where a woman named Martha welcomed him into her home. She had a sister named Mary who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to what he was saying. But Martha was distracted by her many tasks, so she came to him and asked, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the work by myself? Tell her then to help me." But the Lord answered her, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things. There is need of only one thing. Mary has chosen the better part, which will not be taken away from her." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Heather. Now over to Sarah to talk more about that passage.
Thanks, Joe. I don't know if we were going to keep our computers. We've got our Zoom friends on our computers, which is quite important as we lead, so that we can say hi to you guys. Hello, you guys. But we wanted to use the whole screen a little bit more in our services. So, I want to have them at hand here so I can see you as a wave. Hi, Ian. Hello. Thank you. Ah, Martha and Mary, I wonder if any of you have slightly mixed emotions when you hear that story. For me, I always have a slight pang of guilt because I think I would have been Martha, rushing around, trying to sort out the food and the drink, and frankly, being pretty cross with Mary, sitting around and apparently doing nothing. I can pretty much hear my teenage self in those words of Martha. "Mum, don't you care that my sister has left me to do all the work by myself again? Tell her to help me." Just me? Well, I don't know. Maybe it is. But I do think that this story comes with quite a lot of baggage that wasn't really what Jesus was trying to teach us about at all. I mean, there's some baggage in the fact that there are two women arguing about who should be doing the cooking and serving the men. But as we'll see, Jesus is absolutely not advocating some sort of a patriarchal society. Actually, Jesus is supporting women in the most countercultural way imaginable. And then there's some baggage around the sense that this passage is telling us that it's actually better to be spiritually minded than practically minded. Maybe there's a suggestion that you can't be both. Wikipedia goes down this route, that place of all wisdom. Come on, be honest, who goes there first? Yep, not just me, right? Wiki says that the story is frequently interpreted as spiritual values being more important than material business, such as the preparation of food. Well, I guess it's easy enough to make that assumption, that in telling Mary she's chosen the better part to sit at his feet, that Jesus is therefore saying that to do practical stuff is of lesser value. But that's just not true, is it? I mean, firstly, the truth is that unless we have people who are prepared to help practically, we couldn't do church. If we had no one to do the AV or move the chairs or mow the lawn or cook the cakes or make the coffee or do the washing up, whatever it is, we couldn't do church. Practical service is a vital part of following Jesus, and it's the way that we show that we care for each other as church family. What good is it, dear brothers and sisters, asks James in his letter, if you say you have faith, but you don't show it by your actions? Now, there's probably one or two of you who are shuddering going, but it's all about grace, it's all about grace. Yes, yes, of course it's all about grace, the undeserved favour that we receive from grace, but from God. But I do think that James makes a very good point, that how are we to see faith if we don't show it in our actions? And then there's the context of this passage, where it sits in Luke's gospel, because it comes straight after the parable of the Good Samaritan. The priest and the Levite have rushed past the injured man, as you'll remember, apparently in too much of a hurry because they have to go and do their religious duty than practically help an injured man. And Jesus uses the story of the Good Samaritan to teach about what it means to love our neighbour, that faith does show up in practical actions, actions that are highly likely to cut across our comfort zones. Jesus is all about breaking expectations. You see it in the parable of the Good Samaritan, because Samaritans were hated by the religious Jews of the time. And yet, it was the Samaritan who was the one who helped the injured man. And in this story about Martha and Mary, we find a woman sitting at Jesus' feet in a place that was reserved just for the men. And one reason that Martha was cross with Mary was that Mary was really behaving like a man. Back in those days, men and women just did not share the same space in the home. And for them to hang out together was little short of scandalous. But here she was, Mary, sitting at Jesus's feet. And you know, sitting at someone's feet had a very clear implication. It implied that you were their pupil. It wasn't that you were sort of gazing up in adoration. I think we can often have that picture of Mary in this story. There's another story about Mary, isn't there, where she is all about adoration of Jesus, where she breaks that perfume over Jesus's feet, and it's a pure act of love and adoring Jesus. But this is not that. This is Jesus sitting, this is Mary sitting at Jesus' feet, clearly wanting to learn from him. And not only did she want to learn from him, but if you saw her sitting at the feet of a rabbi, there was another implication. And that implication was that she wanted to become a rabbi herself. She wanted to teach and preach the kingdom of God. So no wonder Martha was pretty put out. And yet Jesus is completely fine with it. Not only fine, but he affirms Mary in her position as a pupil and a would-be preacher of the kingdom. He tells her that she's chosen the better part. But what about Martha? She's the one who's doing all the work, making sure that they're all fed. It certainly appears that she is the one who's offering the hospitality and doing all the practical stuff on this occasion. But let's have a look at somebody else who's apparently offering hospitality. Now, this is a bit old for some of us in the room, but I wonder if anyone remembers the 80s sitcom Keeping Up Appearances with Hyacinth Bucket. She liked to call herself Hyacinth Bouquet. She was the star, and in this clip that the guys are about to play for us, her father's died, I think. That's probably the context of the clip. And she's just having her friend around for tea. Let's see what happens next.
Oh, it's you, Elizabeth. A tiny bit early, perhaps, but do come in.
I thought it was 3:25.
No, not quite, dear.
My watch says 3:25.
Oh, that watch. Yes, I expect it would. Shall we go through to the kitchen?
I don't know why you won't let me through your back door.
I think it's so common, don't you, using back doors? No, the proper way for my guests, I always feel, is through the front door.
And then straight into the kitchen?
Well, yes. Unless, of course, it's someone special. Now, I know you're saying to yourself, how is she being so brave? Well, yes, I am brave. My father would wish it. I admit I miss my Sheridan at times like these. He's such a comfort to his mother, as well as being terribly gifted. Do sit down, Elizabeth. Make yourself at home. Oh, not there, dear. I like to face the wind. Lemon? My word. Doesn't someone look smarter than she did earlier? Something new, dear?
No, I've had it ages.
Oh, yes, I can see you have now. I thought we'd have the nicer china.
Oh, thank you, Hyacinth.
There's something of a family heirloom.
Oh, God, don't give me anything special.
So you will be careful, won't you, dear? Biscuit?
Well, thank you.
I used to have six of these until one fell into the hands of my brother-in-law, Onslow, one Christmas. I could have killed him. Of course, one can't make a fuss on festive occasions, but he certainly got the short end of the turkey, I can tell you.
Did they tell you what was wrong with your father?
Something mildly embarrassing. One of those minor geriatric complaints. I couldn't catch the medical terminology. Oh.
I mean, it's often nearer, isn't it? And I can't help but smile a little, but oh my goodness. I think I used to cringe when it was on when I was a kid, and I haven't cringed any less now. She's not exactly... Oh my goodness, we're back on again. No more, please. It's not exactly how to offer hospitality, is it? The hospitality is all on Hyacinth's terms. Her friend has got to conform to all of Hyacinth's expectations. I mean, coming in through the front door, the posh china, the unwanted lemon in the tea, and all the cutting comments are simply about Hyacinth trying to feel superior to her friend. She's judging her friend, comparing herself to her friend. all to make herself feel like she's better than she is or that she feels she is. I'm sure you weren't meant to do the psychology of the sitcom. Probably ruins it, doesn't it? But, you know, that's what you see in it, really, isn't it? And it's complete opposite of true hospitality. Because in true hospitality, we're welcoming others on their terms, not ours. We're authentic and honest. We're offering what we have, not what we don't have. We're giving of who we are, our time, our attention, and our presence. We're making others welcome in their way and on their terms, not on ours. And I wonder if that's partly where things went wrong for Martha in the Bible story that we heard. Martha wasn't really focused on hospitality. We heard that she was distracted by many tasks. She compared herself with her sister rather than doing what she was called to do. And she didn't let her sister do what she was called to do. Jesus notices that Martha is anxious and troubled. And maybe we can begin to see why in what she asks of Jesus. Because her concern seems to be with me all the time. Mary has left me. Tell her to help me. Instead of her focus being on caring for her guest, Jesus. And maybe there's just a smidgen of similarity with Hyacinth Bouquet in that clip. So what does this passage have to do with us today? I think there is a lot about hospitality. Generous hospitality was embedded in the culture of Jesus's day, probably more than it is into our own. For me, I've experienced especially generous hospitality in other cultures. I've been offered to share picnics on train rides in India, been fed hugely generously when I've lived and worked in Nepal for a short time, and indeed enjoyed a Nigerian feast or two from friends not so far away delivered to my door. But I also think of those of you who are hosting Ukrainian friends, who support our cafe and offer wonderful hospitality to the community. I think of the festival last month, which I had absolutely nothing to do with apart from dancing a lot. But I'm so proud that as a church we can offer hospitality, not to raise money as we often see happen, and what a privilege that we don't have to. Don't get me wrong, I understand that churches need to make money somehow, but what a privilege that we were able to just offer something for the joy and the fun of offering it. And there's a messy church party that we've talked about. And I love how hospitality runs in the veins of this church. It's why I'm here. I know I've said that before, but it's what attracted me to the place, and it's what I love. Just one of the things I love. Martha was meant to be offering hospitality. That's what her gift was on that day, to offer her God-given shape and calling for the moment. It's just that it had become all about her, not as extreme as with old Hyacinth maybe, but it was heading that way. You know, there are all sorts of good reasons why we can't all throw our homes open every day, but we can practically support others in doing that, as so many of you have been doing, even this week when you've baked cakes for the cafe we had during the week for the reception class parents, as you're doing supporting Messy Church, as you'll do next week for the Blooming Great Tea Party. I know it seems like it's all about making cakes, but isn't it such a vital thing? I mean, it's so easy to overlook baking. Well, like, I know, you all know I've got a soft spot for cake. But, like, seriously, cake is just some kind of a symbol, isn't it, of the welcome that we want to give. It's luxurious, it's generous, it's fun, and people enjoy coming for cake. And actually, like I said, the tidying up bit too. Thank you for those who do that. But, you know, we can be looking to welcome others on their terms with great love and warmth, sharing the values of God's kingdom as we offer that hospitality. And that's the way that the gospel grows and spreads. It's not so much, in my view, and in these days, delivering evangelical leaflets and street corner preaching. God uses those things. That's fantastic. But the gospel spreads particularly by people like you and me having friends and neighbours over, by sharing our lives with them, the highs and the lows, the reason for the hope that we have, by offering the hospitality of a meal, the hospitality of a cup of tea, or simply the hospitality of a listening ear and a prayer, maybe said at the time, maybe just offered and said at a later date. And that can be in our homes, at work, at the school gate, wherever we find ourselves. That's what we see in the book of Acts, was it was offering hospitality in people's homes where the gospel spread and the church grew. That's what we see happening as a kingdom act of hospitality. So as I finish, this passage reminds us of the importance of hospitality through Martha, maybe slightly through what she wasn't able to do, but it still reminds us that it's really vital in the kingdom. It reminds us that we're called to offer a practical welcome to all those around us, a kingdom welcome, hospitality that shares God's love through us with all around. But also through Mary, this passage reminds us of the importance of learning from Jesus, of sitting at his feet and growing as his disciples, his apprentices, of watching how Jesus does life and doing likewise. We are not called to separate the spiritual and the material, as Wikipedia might have us believe. Far from it, the complete opposite. Jesus showed us a life where learning happens around meal tables and the practical aspects of life illustrated in his teaching. The parable of the sower, the yeast going throughout the bread as an illustration of how the kingdom spreads about. His parables are full of practical life examples. We can keep our eyes on Jesus, whether we're reading the Bible and praying or here at church, or preparing food for a party or getting a wash on at home on Monday morning. Back in the 17th century, there was a monk called Brother Lawrence who gave a great example of that. And he spoke of how we can practice the presence of God in all that we do, in the least practical action or the loftiest prayer. And he's known for describing how he felt as close to God when he was peeling potatoes as he did when he was kneeling at the altar. So as well as an encouragement to keep on practicing hospitality, to keep on learning from Jesus, maybe above all this morning, there's an encouragement for us to practice the presence of God in all things, to keep on bringing our minds back to Jesus in the midst of the most practical tasks, so that we might increasingly live in a sense of his presence and his love, and that we might share that within our community and beyond. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for that story of Martha and Mary and for what it shows us about both the importance of hospitality and also the importance of just sitting at your feet in order to learn from you. Lord, would you help us to practice the presence of God, to look for you, to bring our minds back to you in every activity that we undertake, not to make that divide between the spiritual and the material, because you never did. Lord, would you help us to carry your presence wherever we go, to recognize it in church on a Sunday and doing the washing on a Monday, in having people round for meals and when we say our prayers. Lord, fill us with your spirit that we might radiate your presence and your love. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Sarah. Thank you. Please now stand as we sing, "Be Still for the Presence of the Lord."
Be still for the presence of the Lord, the Holy One is here.
Loving Father, thank you that you are always with us. We pray that as we do spend time with you, listening to you, that we can discern what we hear from you and you show us the light in the darkness and show us the way. Amen. Please do take a seat. And now Linda is going to come and lead us in prayer this morning. Thank you, Linda.
Morning, let us pray together. Lord, we come to you this morning to worship you, to praise you for all you have given us, to ask afresh for your love and grace, and to confess our failings. Help us to know what you have called us to do, and to serve you humbly to the best of our ability in that calling. Thank you for this world, for its beauty and provision. We rejoice in the sunshine, and thank you for opportunities to relax with family and friends at home or on holiday. But we also ask for your protection on those who find the heat debilitating, and those for whom extreme temperatures are life-threatening. May we be good stewards of the resources you have given us, caring for our planet as it suffers in the heat. Help us to be mindful of how we use water, how we enjoy the summer, and how we take care of any who are vulnerable. We pray for the end of year messy church celebration this afternoon. Keep us safe as we celebrate. And we thank you for the families who come to messy church and for the vibrant life of little ones. We pray that they would enjoy the event today and be aware of your love and your blessings. As schools end another long and often difficult year, we pray for teachers, staff and children and their families, that there would be times of relaxation and restoration over the coming weeks. We ask that you would be with those who are coming to the end of an era and moving on to pastures new, that their end of term would be a celebration of all that they have achieved and that they will look forward to new adventures with confidence. We lift our world to you for your ongoing love and protection. Many areas of concern and conflict have slipped out of the news, but we continue to pray for peace and reconciliation in countries where strife threatens life. Be with those who are refugees, that wherever they find themselves, they will be offered comfort physically and emotionally. We pray for those in our church family who particularly need your care at this time. Thank you for safe travels for Alan as he settles back at home after his trip to Rwanda. We pray for Sue Keenan-Vollanman as her leaving service takes place today at the Methodist Church. Be with her as she steps out in faith to continue her work for you. Be with those who are on holiday or soon to be traveling. Keep us safe and help us to walk with you even when we are away from home. We continue to ask for your blessings on Florrie and her family, Jess, Tom, and Lucy. Thank you for the skills of doctors and nurses who are caring for her. We also lift before you Elizabeth, mourning the loss of Tony. Thank you that he now rests with you in peace. Surround Elizabeth with your love and be especially close to the family in the coming days. We pray also for our country in political turmoil. May your wisdom permeate decisions and influence leaders. May your common sense and right way filter through the stubbornness and self-serving that we see. May there be more unity, more care, more love, more balance, more equality, more of you. Lord, we confess that we have not always followed your way, that we've been distracted by our many tasks. There have been moments when we chose other options, when we chose to join in the gossip and not to speak out on behalf of the misunderstood, when we chose to take sides with the strong because we feared the consequences of being found alongside the weak, when we spoke a harsh word of judgment, now regretting what has been said and it can't be taken back, when we allowed pride to get the better of us. We thank you that you do not treat us as our sins deserve, and your love and your word permit a renewed relationship. As we leave this church today, may others see a difference in us. As you forgive us, may we surprise others with our own gift of forgiveness. Shall we conclude our prayers by joining together in the prayer that Jesus taught us? Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you, Linda. And it now gives me great pleasure to announce some bands of marriage. I publish the bands of marriage between Jordan Ash and Becca Ellery, both of this parish. And this is the first time of asking. If any of you know any reason in law why these persons may not marry each other, you are to declare it now. So let's pray for Jordan and Becca as they prepare. Loving Father, be with Jordan and Becca as they prepare, as they organise things for the wedding day. We pray for them and their families. And we pray that you are with them during this time. And we pray that you continue to be with them, strengthen them as they go through their married life. Father, be with them. Amen. And we now have some notices. As if you hadn't already gathered, we do have a bit of a party going on later for Messy Church. So do come along and enjoy the bouncy castle and the barbecue. And we also have morning prayer tomorrow. And this week, we not only have two cafes, but three. We've got the Monday cafe tomorrow, we've got the Wednesday cafe, and also the Blooming Great Tea Party on Thursday, which is in support of Marie Curie. So do come along to those. I think now it's time to hand back to Suzanne. So please stand, if you're able, for the final time as we sing Cornerstone.
I dare not trust the sweetest way.
Thank you. Now, if there's anything that's struck a chord with you or any issues you would like to pray for, then do come and speak to myself or Sarah or somebody else here that you know, but don't go without having prayer. But now, just please remain standing for the blessing. Now, may the Lord of peace himself give you peace at all times and in every way. The Lord be with you all. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, amen.